Welcome to our regular council meeting of Monday, February 3rd, 2014. Mr. Ragus, could you please call the roll?
Here.
Coriel.
Here.
Dunbar.
Here.
Stein.
Here.
Stevens.
Present.
Wilcox.
Here.
Yesenow.
Present.
All present, Your Honor.
Thank you. Next, we'll move to the approval of the minutes of the regular council meeting held on Tuesday, January 21st, 2014, and the approval of the minutes of the public hearing held on Thursday, January 23rd, 2014. I believe there are a couple comments we've received from Councilwoman Yesenow and Councilwoman Dunbar on the regular council minutes, and I have not received any other comments, so I will sign the minutes of the January 21st, 2014 council meeting and the resolutions passed at that meeting, and the minutes of the Thursday, January 23rd, 2014 public hearing at the conclusion of this meeting. Next, we have personal communications from the citizens. This is an opportunity to state your business before council, so if you have any public comment, please step to the podium, state your name and address and your business before council.
Hello, my name is Dr. Joseph C. Walker. I represent Easton Dental. We are a new organization. We're quite not new. We've been around for 47 years. We've moved into this community. We're in East Cleveland. We actually have six offices. We have offices in Cuyahoga Falls, Akron, Lyndhurst on the west side, and in Severance Medical Arts Building. On Sunday, we're going to have a grand opening, and I'm here to invite Council, Finance Director Bradley, and Mayor to our grand opening. We'd like for you to recognize that we're a full-service agency facility. We have the state-of-the-art dental equipment, digital x-rays, implants, CAD-CAM systems, and we're able to really serve the community. We serve all levels of the community economically. We don't deny anybody health care. So I have invitations for everybody here. I think it's appropriate. We're going to have media there, print, radio, and TV, and we'd like to invite all of you out. So I hope that you can come. I'll hang around after the meeting, and we have some personal conversation.
Thank you, Dr. Okay, thank Walker, you. And good luck with your business here in Cleveland Heights.
Well, let me welcome. I'm a member of the organization. I don't own the business. Dr. Carlo Marino and Angela Marino own the practice. They're both dentists, and also Dr. Nassif, him and his wife. We're all dentists, so we're happy to be in Cleveland Heights and serve this community.
Okay, thank we're happy you. To have you here. Thank you. Anybody else?
My girl.
If not?
Diane.
Then, oh, I'm sorry.
Diane Hallam, 1059 Oxford Road.
Good evening.
I'm trying to read from my notes here. Disabled. That is something I do not want to be, but I am. No longer do the same words I used to use to describe myself apply to me today that I used to use. Hardworking, detail-oriented, problem solver, athletic. No longer do I have the ability to think, speak, walk, or listen whenever I want to. I do what I can, and I'm sure to the chagrin of some here, when my body allows me to. No company, organization, or state entity would ever pay me a salary plus benefits for the abilities I have today or the lack thereof. To democracy, the ideal of how citizens elect their own leaders who will serve for a specified period of time for the good of its citizens. But what happens when an elected official becomes disabled? Well, for example, our Ohio House Representative, Barbara Boyd, has not been able to fulfill the duties of her job, which is to attend hearings, vote on legislation, interact with her fellow representatives, or go out and interact with all of her constituents because she has been disabled for nearly 2 years. Her disability is nothing to ridicule or belittle, I should know. But you see, unlike me, who lives out here in the real world where no company would ever keep me on their payroll because I cannot fulfill my job requirements, Representative Boyd is able to stay home and continue to receive a salary and benefits. Me, I became disabled and immediately lost my income.
Ms. Hallam, could you confine yourself to talking to council about issues with the city?
I am getting there.
Okay, thank you.
I have heard last week that after taking her oath of less than 1 month ago on January 6th, our own Janine Boyd, daughter of Representative Barbara Boyd, announced she is running for her mother's Ohio House seat in 2014. The ink is not yet dry on her oath, and after running unopposed for the council seat for which she had originally been appointed and for which she receives over $9,000 as a Cleveland Heights council member, Councilman Boyd will spend her free time campaigning for another elected office. The ideals of democracy are something so grand they should give me goosebumps, but that is not what I am feeling. Because what we actually have here in our community is perverted democracy. Because only in politics can a disabled person keep a position for which they are not able to perform their jobs for almost 2 years, then to decide to retire only after her daughter has gained just enough political experience to run for that same position. So rather than spending her time working with neighbors in her Oxford area community to deal with all our issues there, Ms. Boyd will receive over $9,000 in our tax money to spend her time campaigning for the Ohio House seat. Rather than staying here to help this city and its citizens, she would prefer to go to Columbus to work on big picture items because, of course, they're much more important than we are. Rather than allow Cleveland Heights citizens to elect a capable person from the eager pool of candidates who ran last November, she was willing to spend other people's time and money to campaign for a seat she had planned and hoped to vacate at the end of this year. Rather than Cleveland Heights citizens choosing who will fill the vacancy should Janine Boyd leave, council and its supporters will appoint who they want to fill that seat. Janine's own appointment to council was very odd, because the council only appointed her after throwing out the first set of nominations. It seems they didn't like any of the other Cleveland Heights residents who were more than willing to serve the city back then. So they insisted on another round wherein, to their delight, Janine Boyd was found and nominated. Everyone knows that is how democracy works here in Cleveland Heights. That is why just over 20% of all Cleveland Heights registered voters even participate in our elections.
This recent election plan. 30 seconds to wrap up.
This recent election plan is an outrage, and it thoroughly disgusts me. And I want you to know that I'm not alone in this view. It is abusive to the democratic process. I urge all the citizens out there who may be watching or listening to call City Hall, to call these people, voice your complaint about this abuse of power, We as citizens should have the right to elect.
Diane, this is to address council. Your time is up, please.
Should not be left to an appointment.
Your time's up. Thank you. Anyone else wishing to make a comment tonight?
Hello. My name is Samantha Proventio, and I am a resident of Alandon Drive in Cleveland Heights. I am also the new coordinator for the Heights Community Garden Network. So I wanted to introduce myself to you and to let you be aware of our mission and to thank you for the city's support. The Cleveland Heights Community Garden Network was created to help people interested in community gardens to communicate with each other and connect with each other. And we provide resources and information for those gardeners to help to make their gardens successful, the existing gardens, and to help to create new gardens as there is interest with the residents in the neighborhoods, which jives very nicely with the strategic goals of the vacant parcel committee, who may or may not like to use our services in developing some of those vacant parcels into community gardens. So I just wanted to introduce myself and to let you know we're having a garden leader meeting tomorrow that we'll discuss the future of the network and see how we can better serve the residents in the neighborhoods in creating the gardens, as well as disseminating many seed donations and working on community resources with the network.
Okay, thank you, Samantha.
Samantha, could I just ask, do you guys have a Facebook page or a way to follow what you're doing?
We have a website. We also have a Facebook page. The website is designed to, the quickest and the easiest way for us to give information between the gardens is the website. So it lists a lot of grant opportunities, events, and organizations that are, we try to deal with the local organizations rather than larger businesses. And we do have a Facebook page. So you're welcome to visit both of those.
Website, please. What's the website?
The website is Community Gardens, heightscommunitygardens.net, and then the Facebook page is the same, Heights Community Garden Network.
Samantha, could you tell us the location and time of the meeting tomorrow night?
Sorry. The meeting tomorrow, the garden leaders are going to have basically a business meeting beginning at 7, but then we're welcoming any community gardeners, at 6, and then we're welcoming community gardeners in at 7 o'clock to socialize and talk about needs that they might have that we can address for them.
And where is that
going? This is at the Lee Road Library.
7 p.m. Lee Road Library, Heights Community Gardens Network.
Right.
Okay.
Are you staying till the end of our meeting this evening?
I can.
Okay. I have a series of questions to ask you, and it's inappropriate to delay
the
council meeting.
I can do that.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Any other comments?
My name is Charles Drake. I live on Euclid Heights Boulevard. Going over the agenda for council and knowing the makeup of this council, it almost seems that you have followed Nancy Pelosi's lead, and you must pass it before we know what's in it. The fact that the council still, after the Plain Dealer, has chastised many councils for their emergency clauses, still is passing everything on an emergency clause basis tonight, including increasing fees to taxpayers without any taxpayer comment prior to that.
Can I correct you on the record? We're not passing that ordinance tonight. It's here only on first reading.
Then the agenda is incorrect.
the legislation says it's on first reading.
808-2014 does say first reading.
Your Honor, for the record, the agenda does not say first reading, but the legislation is first reading.
Yeah, I'm sorry, that was an oversight on the agenda. It should have been.
But it is first reading.
It is on the legislation itself, though.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Next, we have the report of the city manager.
Good evening, Your Honor. Thank you. I have two items to report this evening. The first is to request authority to receive proposals from qualified firms to conduct a strategic operations review. I should learn how to say that.
So you're requesting proposals for a strategic operations review. I'll refer that to the Finance Committee.
Mr. Mayor, I make a motion that council allow the city manager to issue a request for proposals for strategic operations review.
Motion has been made. Is there a second?
Second.
Seconded by Councilwoman Yasnow. Mr. Ragus, could you please call the roll?
Coryell?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yasnow?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
That's seven ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. That request for authority has been granted.
Thank you, Your Honor. And finally, it's not listed on the agenda, but I would like to reappoint Nancy Donnelly to the Civil Service Commission for a term to expire in 2016, I believe.
12/31/2016, correct?
Yes, thank you.
All right. You're making that, do we have to vote on that, Mr. Law Director?
I don't believe so. I think I make that a matter of.
Okay, you're making that a matter of record. Thank you. Nancy Donnelly's been reappointed to the Civil Service Commission to the term expiring 12/31/2016.
That concludes my report, Your Honor.
Did you have authority for bids for Lennox and Surrey parking garages you wanted to give to us tonight?
Yes, I do, Your Honor. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
I would like to request authority to receive bids for repairs to the Lennox and Surrey garage.
Okay. That is referred to the Municipal Services Committee of Council. Councilwoman Dunbar?
I would like to, so moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Councilwoman Stevens. Mr. Ragus, could you call the roll?
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yasnow?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coryell?
Aye.
That's seven ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. The request for authority to receive bids for Lennox-Surrey parking garage repairs is granted. Anything else?
I do believe that concludes my report.
Okay, great.
Thank you.
Next, our Director of Finance, Clerk of Council, Mr. Ragus.
I need to notify council that two notices have been received from the Ohio Department of Liquor Control advising that application has been made by the following: H&amp;T Systems Incorporated, stock D5 permit, premises located at 1622 Lee Road, 44118, and also Fitzgerald and Sons LLC, DBA Corey's, transfer D1, D2, D3, and D3A permit, premises located at first floor and basement, 1940-42 South Taylor Road, 44118, to Nick's Bar and Grill LLC, DBA Double R Bar and Grill, premises at first floor and basement, 1940-42 South Taylor Road, 44118. Your Honor, I would like to make this a matter of record.
Thank you. That's made a matter of record and referred to the Public Safety and Health Committee of Council, the city manager, and the Director of Law.
I have nothing else to report tonight, Your Honor.
Thank you. We now move to the committee reports. The first committee is the Finance Committee. Vice Mayor Stevens, please.
Thank you. This evening, we have ordinance number 6, 2014. And I somehow moved it. I got it. It was right where it was supposed to be, and I went somewhere else to look.
This is an ordinance authorizing the city manager to enter into an agreement to execute a tax-exempt lease purchase agreement and related property schedule between U.S. Bank Corp, Government Leasing and Finance, Inc. as leaser, and the City of Cleveland Heights as lessee for the purpose of acquiring an ambulance, including related equipment and appurtenances, and declaring this an emergency. This is a very important piece of equipment that we need to provide emergency medical services and care in Cleveland Heights. So I ask that the City Council pass this as an immediate piece of legislation so that we can begin the process of acquiring the equipment. Thank you.
Thank you. Ordinance 6-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Ragusa, could you please call the roll?
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yazana?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coryell?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
That's 7 ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Ordinance 6-2014 passes.
Mr. Mayor, I have no further legislation this evening.
Thank you. Next, we move to the Municipal Services Committee of Council. Councilwoman Dunbar, please.
I am pleased to present a resolution number 7-2014. It's a resolution authorizing the city manager to enter into an agreement with CT Consultants, Inc. for engineering and support services relative to the planning and implementation of the city's year 2014 street resurfacing program, providing compensation, therefore, and declaring an emergency. The services to be provided by the engineer are as set forth in the proposal and agreement on file with the clerk of council, which is available for inspection. The fees to be paid to CT consultants for the basic routine services as defined in this agreement, basically, the fees are not to exceed $78,000 without additional written authorization from the city manager in a form approved by the director of law. There are several different scenarios laid out. That's the limit on spending. If additional services are required, there will have to be further negotiations. So passage of this resolution shall be given for publishing as usual, and the resolution is hereby declared to be an emergency measure so our city can move ahead on it immediately.
Thank you.
Passage tonight.
Thank you. Resolution 7-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Ragusa, please call the roll.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yazana?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coryell?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
That's 7 ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Resolution 7-2014 passes. Anything else?
No.
That's it. Thank you. Next, we move to the Planning and Development Committee of Council. Councilman Stein.
Thank you, Your Honor. I have on first reading tonight, meaning we will not be voting on this until our next meeting, is Ordinance Number 8-2014. An ordinance implementing sections 3735.65 through 3735.70 of the Ohio Revised Code to establish and describe the boundaries of a community reinvestment area in the Turkey Ridge area of the City of Cleveland Heights, making certain findings and determinations in connection therewith, designing a housing officer to administer the program, creating a community reinvestment housing council, and a tax incentive review council. This council desires to pursue all reasonable and legitimate incentive measures to assist and encourage development in areas of the City of Cleveland Heights that have not enjoyed reinvestment from remodeling or new construction. In particular, at this time, certain parcels of land on Edge Hill Road, Overlook Road, and Kenilworth Mews, hereafter referred to as the Turkey Ridge area, as presented on the map attached. And that map attached is here, Exhibit A. The shaded areas are the areas that this legislation would affect. This council desires to establish a community reinvestment area in Turkey Ridge area, hereafter referred to as the Turkey Ridge Community Reinvestment Area, to encourage exceptional new housing construction and home ownership, and to encourage the remodeling of contributing structures in the Euclid Heights National Register Historic District by granting tax exemption under specific conditions for residential properties within the area, and the maintenance of existing and construction of new structures in the Turkey Ridge area would serve to encourage economic stability, maintain real property values, and generate new employment opportunities. And the remodeling of existing structures or the construction of new structures in Turkey Ridge Community Reinvestment Area constitutes a public purpose for which the property exemptions may be granted. And there are three specifications under Section 4, which are new. The first one is new building construction of owner-occupied dwelling units. And the parameters are having a per-unit investment of no less than $400,000 and a development plan that, upon completion, constitutes an investment of no less than $4 million and that does not demolish or intentionally physically destroy the architectural character and distinguishing features of contributing buildings in the Euclid Heights National Register Historic District, may file a real property tax exemption application for a period of 15 years for 100% of the incremental assessed taxes as a result of the construction. The next one is new building construction of owner-occupied dwelling units having per-unit investment of no less than $400,000 and a development plan that, upon completion, constitutes an investment of no less than $1.6 million and that does not demolish or intentionally physically destroy the architectural character and distinguishing features of contributing buildings in the Euclid Heights National Register of Historic District. May file a real property tax exemption application for a period of 7 years at 100% of the incremental assessed taxes as a result of the construction. And the final, the third category, rehabilitation for residential dwelling units in contributing buildings of the Euclid Heights National Register Historic District that follows the Secretary of the Interior standards for rehabilitation and that has a minimum investment of $500,000 in rehabilitation costs, may file a real property tax exemption application for a period of 10 years for 100% of the incremental assessed taxes as a result of the rehabilitation. That a community reinvestment area housing council shall be created for the Turkey Ridge Community Reinvestment Area consisting of two members appointed by the city manager and two members appointed by this council and one member appointed by the Planning Commission. The majority of the members shall then appoint two additional members, both of whom shall be residents of Cleveland Heights. Terms of members of the council shall be for 3 years. An unexpired term consulting from a vacancy in the council shall be filled in the same manner as the initial appointment was made. The community reinvestment area shall make an annual inspection of the properties within the Turkey Ridge Commercial Community Reinvestment Area, for which an exemption has been granted under Section 3735.67. The council shall hear appeals pursuant to Section 3735.70 of the Ohio Revised Code. So this is the legislation that, again, is on first reading tonight. So if you have an opinion on this, contact council. Let us know your opinions by phone, by email, or by coming to our next council meeting. That is all I have.
Okay. Ordinance 8-2014 has been offered on first reading only. And, again, this ordinance is available from our clerk of council as well. Is that it for your report?
Yes, that is.
All right. Next, we have Public Health and Safety, Public Safety and Health Committee of Council, Councilwoman Boyd.
Thank you, Your Honor. This evening, I have on first reading as well, Ordinance Number 9-2014, which amends Sections 1311.51 and .051 and .053, 1311.06 and .07, 1311.071. 1311.09 and .10, 1311.11 of Part 13, Building Code of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, to increase certain fees to more adequately cover the administrative costs of providing related services and repealing the existing sections. And again, this is the first reading.
Thank you. Ordinance 9-2014 has been offered on first reading only, and again, this will be available for review from the clerk of council.
Thank you, Your Honor. I also have resolution number 10-2014, which declares the operation of a bar located at 2573 Noble Road, the Bayou, to be a nuisance, authorizing abatement of the nuisance and declaring that, indeed, an emergency. Whereas the chief of police has reported that the police have been dispatched to the Bayou at least 34 times since April 1st, 2012, in response to various complaints of disturbance. And again, on September 8th, 2013, and on January 24th, 2014 for escalated disturbances. It is hereby found and determined by this council pursuant to Chapter 553 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights and Ohio law that the operation of the bar located at 2573 Noble Road, Cleveland Heights, Ohio, the Bayou, is a blighting influence and a hazard to the health and safety of patrons, neighbors, and the public, and is hereby declared to be a public nuisance. The city manager, the director of housing, and the director of law are authorized and directed to cause the nuisance to be abated in accordance with Chapter 553 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, or in any manner determined by them to be appropriate and in accordance with law, including but not limited to revocation of a certificate of business occupancy. So I submit resolution number 10-2014 for approval this evening.
Thank you. Resolution 10-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? I would just like to state that this is another example of council taking action against a business that we don't believe should be in any neighborhood in the city. We don't care where you live, whether it's our neighborhood or your neighborhood. This type of business does not belong in our city and in the way it's been operating. So Mr. Ragus, please call the roll.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yazanov?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coriel?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
That's seven ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Resolution 10-2014 passes.
Thank you, Your Honor. Next, I have resolution number 11-2014, which declares the property at 14,321 Superior Road, Cleveland Heights, Ohio, to be a nuisance, authorizing abatement of the nuisance and declaring that an emergency. Whereas the city manager and the certified building official have reported to this council that the residential property at 14,321 Superior Road has not been maintained, is currently vacant, and is in a state of severe disrepair, and have further reported that the owner of the subject property has been cited by the Housing Inspection Department for numerous housing code violations on the property over the last 8 years, and no progress has been made toward correction of the violations, and that the property has deteriorated over the years to the point that it is a hazard to the health, safety, and welfare of potential occupants and the public, and is a blighting and deteriorating factor in the neighborhood adversely affecting the value of neighboring property. Therefore, the city manager, certified building official, and director of law are authorized and directed to cause the nuisance to be abated in accordance with Chapter 553 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, or in any manner determined by them to be appropriate and in accordance with law. I submit resolution number 11-2014 for approval this evening.
Thank you. Resolution number 11-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Ragus, please call the roll.
Yazanov?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coriel?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
That's seven ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Resolution 11-2014 passes.
Thank you, Your Honor. Lastly, I have resolution number 12-2014, also declaring the property at 14,327 Superior Road, Cleveland Heights, Ohio, to be a nuisance, authorizing abatement of the nuisance and declaring an emergency. Whereas the city manager and the certified building official have reported to this council that the residential property known as 14,327 Superior Road has not been maintained, is currently vacant, and is in a state of severe disrepair, and have further reported that the owner of the subject property has been cited by the Housing Inspection Department for numerous housing code violations on the property over the last 6 years, and no progress has been made toward correction of the violations, and that the property has deteriorated over the years to, again, the point that it is a hazard to the health, safety, and welfare of potential occupants and the public, and is a blighting and deteriorating factor in the neighborhood adversely affecting the value of neighboring property. Therefore, again, the city manager, certified building official, and director of law are authorized and directed to cause the nuisance to be abated in accordance with Chapter 553 of the Codified Ordinances of the City of Cleveland Heights, or in any manner determined by them to be appropriate and in accordance with law. I submit resolution number 12-2014 for approval this evening.
Thank you. Resolution 12-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Ragus, please call the roll.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coriel?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yazanov?
Aye.
That's seven ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Resolution 12-2014 passes.
And just a few announcements. Up and running now on our city website under the Cleveland Heights Police tab, you will find all incident reports beginning February 1st and moving forward. There are about 40 up already, and that includes accident reports. So if you're in an accident, you can even pull up your report and download that. I'd also like to remind everyone to please, please, please lock your car doors, even in your own driveway. Our chief of police estimates that roughly 95% of our car thefts so far have happened to unlock cars. So please lock your car doors. And that's it for me this evening.
And that the thefts are usually just items laying on the front seat of a car. It's not the car itself, but
if
you leave your cars unlocked and there's valuables laying on the front seat or anywhere in the car, they're likely, or not likely, but they can be easily taken, let's put it that way. Thank you. Next, we have the Administrative Services Committee of Council. Councilwoman Yasnow.
I do not have any legislation tonight, Your Honor. I do move for the appointment of Jordan Burris for a 4-year term to the Recreation Advisory Board, as well as for the reappointment of Alyssa Branford for a term expiring May 31st, 2015, and the reappointment of Ted Esborne and Sean Sullivan for terms expiring May 31st, 2017.
Those motions have been made to appoint those individuals to the Recreation Advisory Board. Are there any seconds?
Second.
Councilman Stein seconds. Mr. Raguse, could you please call the roll?
Coryell?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yasnow?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
That's 7 ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Mr. Burris is appointed to a 4-year term. Alyssa Branford reappointed to the term expiring 5/31/2015. And Ted Esborne and Sean Sullivan to the terms expiring May 31st, 2017.
I would also like to take a moment to address the citizens here tonight. To piggyback on what Councilwoman Boyd said, please do remember to lock your doors. Look and lock before you leave. Please look for your valuables and take them or hide them. And please lock your car doors before you leave, whether it is in your driveway or even if it is in your garage. These are crimes of opportunity, and we hope to make Cleveland Heights a safer place with you. So thank you. Additionally, I have some less than pleasant news about the weather. On Tuesday evening, we are expecting anywhere from 6 to 10 inches of snow. Yeah, and it looks like we're going to be getting the same on Saturday evening as well. So everybody, please take the precautions necessary. Make sure you have salt, snow scraper, shovels, give extra time for your commutes for Wednesday morning, and please remember to also take care of your sidewalks. We have many people in the community who walk with their pets for exercise, senior citizens. So please take care to shovel your sidewalks when appropriate and safe during this upcoming snowstorm. And finally, I'd like to give a congratulations and a shout out to the Cleveland Heights Fire Department, who will be on the CHEW tomorrow afternoon, 1 p.m. ABC. On ABC, where they were cooking with local chef Michael Simon. So before you get ready for the approaching storm, relax and enjoy. And that is all that I have for this evening.
Thank you. We'll be looking forward to that. Not the weather, of course.
I was going
to
say.
Next, Community Relations and Recreation Committee of Council. Councilman Coryell.
Thank you, Mayor Wilcox. I'm pleased to put forward two resolutions tonight. First, I have resolution number 13-2014, a resolution to declare February 2014 American Heart Month. This is a very important resolution because cardiovascular disease is responsible for approximately 1 in 4 deaths in the United States and is in fact the leading cause of death among both men and women. The risk factors for cardiovascular disease include smoking, high blood pressure, high cholesterol, obesity, physical inactivity, diabetes, family history, and age. The research is clear that tools are available to increase survival rates of cardiovascular disease, with the encouraging of citizens to help save lives by calling 911 if symptoms occur, become trained in CPR, and support automated external defibrillator programs in our communities. City Council joins the American Heart Association and numerous governmental agencies in declaring February as American Heart Month. in order to raise awareness about heart disease and to help make sure that people make healthy lifestyle choices to reduce their own risk. So this resolution will proclaim February 2014 American Heart Month. Notice of the resolution will be published in the newspaper, and we are declaring this an emergency in the sense that February is already upon us, and it would be good for this this resolution to take effect immediately before the month is over.
Thank you. Resolution 13-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Ragus, please call the roll.
Dunbar?
Aye.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yazanow?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coryell?
Aye.
That's 7 ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Resolution 13-2014 passes.
I also am proud to put forward resolution number 14-2014, which is a resolution for Cleveland Heights to declare February 2014 as National African American History Month. As we know, the city of Cleveland Heights is rich in its diversity of cultures and races. Cleveland Heights takes great pride in the harmonious relationships that exist among and within the city's many diverse communities. The council recognizes the importance of explaining and sharing the rich cultural and spiritual heritage of each of the city's various ethnic groups to foster and encourage harmony and understanding among these groups. So this resolution declares the month of February 2014 to be National African American History Month in the city of Cleveland Heights, in recognition of the accomplishments and contributions of African American citizens to this community and to our country. We reaffirm our commitment to maintain Cleveland Heights as a truly integrated community and to continue the tradition of appreciation and respect for our cultural diversity. This resolution will be published in the newspaper, and it's declared an emergency for similar reasons as the last resolution.
Thank you. Resolution 14-2014 has been offered. Are there any comments or questions? Mr. Ragus, please call the roll.
Stein?
Aye.
Stevens?
Aye.
Wilcox?
Aye.
Yazanow?
Aye.
Boyd?
Aye.
Coryell?
Aye.
Dunbar?
Aye.
That's 7 ayes, Your Honor.
Thank you. Resolution 14-2014 passes.
Mr. Mayor, I would like to just briefly comment in addition about African American History Month. This is also an observance now in Canada and the UK as well as the United States for remembrance of important people and events in Black history around the world. It was created by African American historian Carter G. Woodson in 1926. In the language of the time, it was called Negro History Week. And the week chosen was chosen because of the birthdays of Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln. It was first expanded to Black History Month in 1976 by the Black Students Union in nearby Kent State University. Black History Month, it's important to note, is meant to unite, not to divide. It's not about having a separate history, but an inclusive history. As Carter Woodson wrote back in 1926, again using the language of the time, we should emphasize that it is not Negro history, but the Negro in history. What we need is not a history of selected races or nations, but a history of the world that is void of bias, of hate, and of prejudice. So I urge residents to find out about Black History Months in Cleveland Heights and participate. Check with the library, your church, your schools. For example, the Forest Hill Church is hosting a screening of the movie Beasts of the Southern Wild, followed by a discussion at 7 p.m. on February 7th. And also a book discussion of The New Jim Crow by Michelle Alexander on Sunday, February 23rd from 12:30 to 2 p.m. The Harlem Renaissance play, Knock Me a Kiss, continues at the Ensemble Theater, and thanks to a grant from the Cuyahoga Arts and Culture Foundation, there will be jazz music and poetry reading preceding each performance on Friday or Saturday night, and that runs through February 23rd. Finally, I want to advise everyone that auditions for the 2014 Kane Park Theater production of The Frogs, a play by Aristophanes of ancient Greece, as adapted by Bert Chevalone and Nathan Lane, with music and lyrics by Stephen Sondheim, will take place February 28th through March 2nd. You can call to make audition appointments at 291-2323, and the play will be staged from July 31st to August 17th at Kane Park. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Next, it's time for the mayor's report. I just had a couple of things I wanted to say. One, as you know, the schools are in the process of going through the design and architectural review process for the new high school. And there are going to be a number of community meetings held at the high school, and I think maybe other places in the city. But the first one is being held at the social room at the high school on February 6th, this Thursday at 6 to 8:30. That's been rescheduled because of some of the adverse weather we've had in recent weeks. So if you can make it there, hopefully that'll be between the storms we heard about coming in. But Thursday night, it's really, this is an opportunity to make an impact in what that building will look like. And because it is in the design phase, so nothing has been set in stone in terms of the final look and how the building will work. So this is your opportunity. And then also just a comment about the winter weather we've been having. I know I've been amazed how much snow we've already had. I think we've already had the normal amount of snow for the year. And I encourage residents that can get out to shovel their walks, obviously. But I actually wanted to thank people in the city that go above and beyond. And we have people in my neighborhood that do that. All of a sudden, you go outside and the whole block is plowed. And where did that happen? But just wanted to thank the people that get up and do that. They don't ask for anything. They just go out and do it. And it makes Cleveland Heights what it is. So with that, I'm going to close this meeting at 8:31. Our next council meeting is Tuesday, February 18th. Thank you.